Yeah, I'm Terry Cottle, and I'm a psychiatrist in town, and I'm honored to be a part of this. I appreciate Bob and Jerry asking me to participate. I've certainly been a part of a lot of psychiatric conferences, and I've been a part of some Christian mental health things, but I've never been a part of a multi-faith group also looking at mental health, and so I'm very excited about this integration and this process. My answer to this question about how can mental health professionals and faith communities work together to help people starts, I think my answer comes from my own history. I grew up here in Greensboro. I attended church here in Greensboro as a kid, and I actually met my first psychiatrist at church. He came to speak at our church. His name is Basil Jackson. He's from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and you can look up his CV right now when we talk. He's the most educated man that I have ever met, at least that I know of. He has at least 4 doctoral degrees and maybe 5. It was a little hard to tell from the CV. But in addition to being a psychiatrist, he's also had subspecialty training in addictions, in forensic psychiatry, child psychiatry, and psychoanalysis. In addition to that, he also has a law degree. And I went to visit him after I finished my residency in psychiatry in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And we went out to dinner, and I kept seeing these people come up and say, "Hey, Dr. Jackson." So what's that all about? We also had a call-in radio show in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Quite a guy. So he had a pretty big impact on me. But at the church where he spoke and I attended, there were leaders in the church who were supportive, obviously, because they invited the psychiatrist to come and speak there, supportive of the idea that Christians could legitimately seek psychiatric care or mental health care. But there are also leaders on the same elder board, others who were not supportive of that. They felt like that if you had enough faith, you don't need Prozac. And so I was aware of that tension then, and that tension still exists to some degree. I think I'm old enough to have seen a lot of change, and I'm thankful for that, but that tension still exists, and it prompted me as a young Christian to want to pursue psychiatry. When I was thinking about what I wanted to say to you today, I almost feel like the Lord orchestrated this because I had been invited to participate in this, and I was thinking, well, what am I going to say? I had a woman who saw me just recently. She has bipolar disorder. I'll call her Jane. She's a professional woman. She's had bipolar disorder for a number of years, but she's been very stable. I only see her a couple of times a year just to make sure everything's okay, check a few labs and so forth. But at her last visit, she took time out and said, you know, I just wanted to let you know how much I appreciated the way you handled me those years ago, because she really struggled with the idea of having bipolar disorder. She had some behavioral changes, she was talking fast, she couldn't sleep, she couldn't concentrate, she was agitated. It was noted by her coworkers. They sent her to the doctor. The doctor sent her to me, and she said, I just think it's hormonal. If I just get my hormones right, I'll be okay. Can't we try a hormonal approach? And I said, no, this is bipolar disorder, and you need to take it with you. Well, she really struggled with that. Her husband did, too. She knew that I was a Christian. I knew she was a Christian. So in that those first couple of sessions, I prayed with her. And what her comments to me were, just recently, she wanted to tell me how much that had meant to her. And I don't do that very often, but I did in that situation. And it really made her feel much more willing to accept the idea that she had a psychiatric diagnosis and be willing to accept treatment. She went on to say, and this really struck me, she said, at that time, I would rather you have told me that I had cancer than bipolar disorder. Because she said, if I had cancer, I could go to my church and I could tell them I had cancer and they would pray for me and I would be supported. But I could not tell them I had bipolar disorder. And that spoke volumes to me. You know, there was a day that, and most of us don't remember this, but there was a day when cancer was a death sentence, and people didn't want to talk about it. They called it the C word. But nowadays, celebrities talk about having cancer, and it is something that's very open. I hope that the day will come that we'll continue to destigmatize mental illness, and people can talk about having bipolar disorder as openly as they can talk about having cancer. So I think that's what this is about. Thank you.
Thank you, panelists. Let's give them another round. Our panelists will be available at lunchtime to have discussions with you or to answer questions. So they're not going back to their offices immediately, and they'll be hanging around the building where we all registered this morning. So if you'd like to touch base with them, please do so then. Another small housekeeping piece is that in your handout, or in your booklet, there is a yellow sticky. And this is for questions that you have for our panelists, either about your own, again, personal comments, perhaps something about the next two scenarios that we're about to read together, or perhaps something about the video that you saw this morning. And if I could see a show of hands for the people who will be collecting these stickies. Okay, all right. Who else is around? Okay. So as you have a question, if you could just, and you have it written down in your sticky, if you just put it up, we'll have someone come around and collect it. And then our panel will answer your questions following the scenarios we're about to read. So, and also more about your panelists, if you'd like more information about them, it's in, I think, the second page of the handout. Okay, let's go ahead and do case study number one. And case study number one will be commented on by Dr. Klosky and Mr. Fred May. What we're going to do is read this together, and they're just going to offer us some brief comments. Then we will go on to case number two, followed by remarks by Dr. Gladney and Dr. Carrie Cotton. So, case number one, Anthony, the assembly line worker. Anthony is a 51, and this is, I think it's, excuse me, the second page from the end in your handout. Anthony is a 51-year-old father of two sons, married for 25 years, devout deacon in his church. He's been employed as an assembly line worker for over 10 years and recently got a promotion. He has worked alongside Barbara for over 10 years. They have grown close over the years and dealt with a lot of rough times in their lives. Families got to know each other and spent a lot of time with each other over the years. A few months ago, Barbara's husband died suddenly. Barbara took 2 weeks off and then came back, but she didn't seem the same. Anthony spent a lot of time at work trying to talk to her. He found himself feeling closer to her and then started feeling attracted to her. He wanted to hold her. He then found himself feeling his own marriage was empty and that bickering with his wife started to increase. As his sons finished high school and were picking colleges, Anthony began to feel torn. Could he stay in this marriage? He started becoming distracted at work, could not concentrate. He started to feel sad, guilty, and lost. He lost his ability to enjoy things, didn't want to socialize, play cards, and he stopped reading. He started sleeping much less, he began losing weight, and started missing work. He comes to you for help. So we have Dr. Klosky and Mr. Fred May. I think you're going to respond.
So the stressor, any stressor that we all have, is obviously a common response is to get depressed over something. But Anthony's response wasn't just a reactive sadness or grief or minor. He fell into what described as the major depression pit, off the road. It's not just being sad, it affects his functioning, his ability to sleep and eat and so forth. So when it gets to that degree, it's believed that there is some chemical change in his brain and that what is necessary at that time is to treat him for major depression. The treatment for major depression is really four interventions. The first is to use an antidepressant, which takes weeks, even a month or two to work. But also because he's not sleeping, he should be given a sleeping aid, because when you get a good night of sleep, right away you feel better the next day. So he needs a sleeping aid and he needs an antidepressant. Besides improving all of his symptoms and taking maybe weeks or a month, the other thing it does is it makes him a better candidate for the second part of the treatment, which is psychotherapy. Because he was a deacon in his church, because there's a religious tone to him, I would pick somebody, hopefully, and I know all the therapists in Greensboro, so I kind of pick somebody who would match him. And I would probably pick Fred May. So he needs a therapist in Fred. He needs my Zoloft and my Restoril to help him sleep. He also needs to know that I'm there all the time if his depression got severe enough that he got suicidal. So he would be given the number to my office to call anytime. The fourth thing is we would have an open discussion about his job. And we ask the question, is going to work right now an asset or is it a liability? Is it better to take some time off? And I would be there to write him a letter, to take him out for 2 to 3 to 4 weeks until Fred gets to see him and his medicine starts to work. That's what I would do as the tow truck operator, pulling him out of the ditch.